So saying سَمِعَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمِدَ is also a wajib act of the salah itself. And then following that, you say at the minimum, which is رَبَّنَا وَلَكَ الْحَمْدُ. And this is because they are of the actions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he never left it off. Never ever did he leave off these actions before, so they become naturally part of the salah. The fourth wajib act is the first tashahhud after the second pair of prostrations. The first tashahhud. Forget about the second part that I just mentioned. After the second pair of prostrations, just think of the first tashahhud of a salatu ruba'i, or the four raka'at prayers. That first tashahhud is a wajib act. Now this is interesting. Let's say you're praying Isha and you forget to sit down for that first tashahhud after those two raka'ah or those raka'atayn. So what do you do here? Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah has a very interesting way of getting out of this problem. And this happened to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where also he himself had forgotten to sit down for this middle tashahhud. And the companions, they sat down. But the Prophet ﷺ, he continued to stand up and he started the third rak'ah without that middle tashahhud. So the Prophet ﷺ, and he's up, he's standing up, and he knows that the companions, some of them, maybe not all of them, but some of them may just remain sitting down. So what did the Prophet ﷺ do? He took his hand and he just gave them the gesture to get up. And it just kind of looked like this from the back, to stand up and continue to follow me. And then after that, he spoke to the companions, and the companions said to him, Ya Rasulullah, we thought that being revealed or being inspired upon you. And the Prophet ﷺ explained to them what just happened. The point here is that the Prophet ﷺ, he continued to stand for that third raka'ah, which shows you that that first tashahhud is a wajib act of the salah itself. Now, Imam Shafi'i has an interesting way of explaining when and how you should do this. Imam Shafi'i says that if you happen to be sitting and the Imam stands up for the third raka'ah, now, if you happen to be the one praying, should you go back and sit down again, or should you always stand up each and every time you miss that first tashahhud? So for example, if the Imam is praying and he stands up for that third raka'ah and somebody at the back reminds him that you're supposed to be sitting down, so they say Subhanallah, and the Imam, what does he do here? Does he just give the gesture like the Prophet ﷺ, or does he go back and sit down and then do the sajda to sahu at the end? Imam Shafi'i says you have one of two choices here. If your body happens to be closer to standing up or for the qiyam, then you continue standing. But he says that if your movement is closer to the sitting position, then you should get back and sit down. It's such a technical detail that Imam Shafi'i gets from this problem or this issue. But the point is that it gives you a lot of wisdom of how to implement this this issue if it ever comes up. This is why I say it's extremely important that the people who lead salah are people who have some basic fundamentals and training of the salah. I know it's always nice to have the kids lead the prayer once in a while, and I support that 100%. Wallahi, I support when the youngsters who are memorizing Quran and who are hafiz and so on, wallahi, I love you for the sake of Allah, and I support you 100% if you want to come and take that opportunity to feel what it feels like to be the Imam of the Salah. However, let's be honest here. This is not a position for you. Because leading the jama'ah in a salah it doesn't need just Quran. It needs fundamentals in the deen. It needs fiqh. It's not restricted to just memorizing Quran, and you can pull out Surah Nur or Surah Yunus or something and just throw it out and make the salah really long. Like that's a lot of the things, that's what the kids, that's what they're trained to just focus on. If the child or whoever's leading us in salah happens to miss out on this, or they forget a wajib act. How many of them really know what they're supposed to do? And what happens if after the salah someone criticizes them? They need to be able to respond to that. They need to be able to handle those situations. So whoever leads us in the salah must have some basic fundamentals of what would happen if they miss or they add extra parts of the prayer itself. So it's important. So the sitting for the first tashahud. Now, just so you know, there is no most correct or rajih opinion in terms of the choice that you make here. You use your judgment. If you happen to be closer to standing up, then continue to stand. But if you happen to be closer to sitting down or to the sitting position and you remember, wait a minute, I'm supposed to be down here for tashahud, get back down and sit, and then inshallah follow with a sajda to sahu before you end the salah. Now, some scholars in particular of the Hanbali madhab are of the opinion that the salam and the salah upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is also wajib as part of the prayer. But the majority of the ulama, when we say the majority of the madhahib say that when sending peace and blessings to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is not a wajib or an obligatory act of the salah itself. However, Umar al-Faruq radiyallahu anhu used to teach the people the tashahud from the minbar, from the pulpit, and he did not mention the salutations or the salat and the salam ala nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam when he was teaching them. So this is one way to look at this picture. However, I don't want you to rely on this. What I want you to do inshallah, or as a responsibility for our salah, is that we always try to do at least the bare minimum, even if an act is sunnah of the salah. Don't be amongst the people where ilm is punishing them rather than rewarding them. You want to know how ilm goes against you? Ilm goes against a student of knowledge when they grow up doing something thinking that this was wajib upon them. But as they continue learning, they realize that, wait a minute, I always thought that it was wajib, but now I learned it's just sunnah, or it's just mustahab, or it's just mubah. So what happens? They start to become lazy, slowly and slowly. Because why? They can always just tell themselves, it's just sunnah anyways. It's just sunnah anyways. This is when, you know, the ulama, they say, this is when ilm is against you now. And possibly ilm could punish you on yawm al-qiyamah for this. So don't always allow your nafs or allow yourself to look for these comfort zones in the salah itself. Treat all of these things as though they're wajib upon you. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed qiyamul layl every single night, and he made it wajib upon himself. He proned himself to do it each and every single night. Qiyamul layl, I have a whole discussion for you. A whole discussion on the virtues of qiyamul layl. How qiyamul layl can increase your rizq from Allah Azza wa Jal. How qiyamul layl can also bring acceptance from Allah Azza wa Jal in your life. And how qiyamul layl is the source that brings nur, that puts barakah in your life, that puts barakah in your ilm. And how qiyamul layl, how qiyamul layl actually makes you feel brighter and more awake each and every single day. Qiyamul layl actually makes you feel brighter and more awake each and every single day. As Ibn Hajar rahimahullah once mentioned in his majmu', he says, wallahi, not in his majmu', his sharh, his explanation in Bukhari, he says, wallahi, uqsimu billah. He says, wallahi, by Allah, the person who prays Qiyamul Layl consistently will never feel tired during the day. Will never feel tired during the day. Next one, we want to look at some of the manners. So we want to look now at some of the manners of the prayer, but we're not going to look at just some basic standard akhlaq issues. We want to look at some of the key issues and some of the controversial ones as well, and have an idea what some of the ulama they mentioned regarding this. Number one, when it comes to the manners and the akhlaq of the prayer, with regards to the position of the hands in the prayer itself, there is nothing authentic and clear that has been reported from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on where you should put the hands exactly. There's nothing authentic, sahih, or clear where exactly should your hands be. So as a result, the ulama they advise us that you should basically put your hands wherever you're comfortable keeping them. And some of the ulama, they have like slight differences of opinion regarding this. Like Imam Abu Hanifa, he mentions that in his madhab, he mentions that the hands should be just below the navel area. Just below the navel area. He even mentions and he explains that part of the hands should be above the navel and part of it should be just below it as well. That's one opinion or one way. Number two, now many scholars, they criticized it for a number of different reasons, simply because the awrah is considered to be below the navel. So many ulama, they criticized that position, but they never rejected it as a whole. The second opinion is Imam Malik's madhab, rahmatullahi alayhi, he mentions that it should be wrist to wrist, wrist to wrist. Now, this here, we have an issue, and that is putting the hands together, you know, as part of the mas'ala. What's Imam Malik's position regarding this, as opposed to those, in regards to those who keep their hands down to the sides? Now, what's interesting is that a lot of the people who do this, they say that this is something that you can find in Imam Malik's madhab. They are not mistaken. You can actually find this. I personally have also found some hadith or some evidences that Imam Malik has used regarding this, that the Prophet ﷺ could have done this at least, or have allowed some of his companions to do this at some point in his lifetime. But here's the problem. The problem is it goes back to that same principle that we mentioned just in the beginning, that the Prophet ﷺ never left anything explicit about this position. So that's why a lot of people, they just adapted this method from Imam Malik. But you know what's interesting? The one authentic or good acceptable hadith that Imam Malik brings when it comes to this issue is to fold the hands, and it's mentioned in his Muwatta. So in his Muwatta, he actually brings a hadith that mentions the Prophet ﷺ used to fold his hands, and this is something that we should do as well. So even though Imam Malik had this issue or had this part of this opinion as part of his madhab, he still kind of leans you over to do the best and most correct position, which is to fold the hands. Some people have said that one of the reasons why Imam Malik, rahimahullah, used to keep the hands down is because of an injury that he suffered. He was beaten almost to death during his lifetime. As a matter of fact, there is even one time that's mentioned that Imam Malik, because of a statement that he made against the leader during his time, they shaved his head bald and they took off his clothes, but just wrapped his awrah area with a piece of cloth, placed him on a donkey cart and walked around him throughout his city, humiliating him. So he went even to that extent as part of some of the difficulties that they went through during their lifetime. But still, Imam Malik, rahimahullah, during that time, during all those problems, he was beaten almost to death. Imam Ahmed also had the same thing. Imam Ahmed was beaten to such an extent that every single time when he was beaten, layers of his skin would fall off. And in the evening, a surgeon would come, would pick up the layers of skin and stitch it back onto his body. Then the next day he would be beaten in that same spot and the same layer would fall again. Then the surgeon would come and pick up that piece and stitch it back over and over again. And this would happen continuously until eventually a miracle happened to Imam Ahmed, rahimahullah, where the ground shook because his izar or his garment was about to fall down of how much times he was being beaten. So eventually Allah Azza wa Jal caused a miracle to happen to him where the ground shook and everybody who was beating him fell down and his izar stayed up. He was freed away from the chains and he was able to tie his izar by himself. This has happened, this is narrated in a number of different authentic books, that, including Imam Al-Dhahabi, Imam Nawawi, rahimahullah. They mention a lot of interesting events that happened to some of the ulama. Imam Al-Dhahabi has one of, you know, the most spectacular things I've ever heard. Imam An-Nawawi himself, there are also some narrations with him as well. Nevertheless, going back to this issue, we come to the Shafi'i opinion. The Shafi'i opinion is under the chest. Under the chest, just upon the upper part of the stomach. Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, he mentions both. He mentions below the navel. He also mentions in his madhab above the navel as well. So when you look at all of this as a whole, wherever you find comfortable, inshallah, is acceptable. The question here is that how do you fold your hands? You find that some people, they will take their forearm and they will hold on to it. Then you'll find that others will be wrist to wrist. You'll find that others will do this, will have their palm on top of the outer palm of their left hand. You find that there are different versions of how to do this. There are three main ways that are mentioned in some of the scholars who wrote about the description of the Prophet's prayer. They include, the first one is you take the wrist, the inner palm of your right hand and you place it to the outer palm of your left hand. And this will be anywhere you want, between the navel and the chest area. Now there is one good hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was narrated that very, you know, a lot of times the companions narrated that they most commonly used to see him do this position, where it would be more towards the higher chest area, and he would have his hands like this. There is a second way that is also a good and acceptable manner, which is you take the right hand and you place it on the left forearm. You know, place it on the left forearm, and this is fine. Many ulama discourage for you to grab and hold on to this forearm because that encourages some level of laziness in the salah itself. Because what you'll find is that some people will just hold on, you know, some people will just do this, you know, just kind of grab onto their thobe or something and just kind of hold on. So it discourages that event as well. Third one is the wrist to wrist. So you have your wrist line up to this wrist here and anywhere on the chest area, this is also acceptable. As I said, just to summarize it, whatever you feel comfortable, inshallah, is also acceptable. Reason why, we don't have explicit, clear, authentic evidence to support any of this. Next manner when it comes to the salah is, there are three places in the prayer where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would occasionally keep quiet. He would occasionally keep quiet. Number one, was immediately after the opening takbir of the salah itself. When we say he would keep quiet, it means that you wouldn't be able to hear what he was saying. Occasionally you would. There are times, there are certain narrations that the Prophet ﷺ would say whatever dua he was saying at that moment, but it was for the purpose of teaching the companions what should be said at that particular time. So that's number one. Number two is immediately after reciting the Fatiha. And obviously this is to give an opportunity to the jama'ah to respond with the Ameen. And also to recite Surah Fatiha as well if it's one of the silent prayers. And the third time is one just before going down to the ruku'. Just before going down to the ruku'. So you finish the Fatiha, then you say you recite your surah. When you're done the surah, so for example, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدَ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُلَّهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدْ. and then you go down for ruku. Allahu Akbar. That slight pause. Now that pause here, it's mentioned, Imam An-Nawawi mentions that that pause there is only for a brief moment. It shouldn't be a pause that, you know, it kind of makes the flow of the salah awkward. It was just for a brief and short duration. Another manner is in terms of reciting the basmala out loud or not. So this is the basmala that you recite before the Fatiha and before the surah that you choose. So just I just want to make sure that all of our minds are in the same place. So that, this is why I want to use just a demonstration so you can have the right image. So you say Allahu Akbar, and then you do your dua. And now before you want to start the Fatiha, you say out loud, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. And then you continue the Fatiha. Waladdallin. Ameen. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alif Lam Mim. And then you continue your surah. So this basmala that happened here, what's the discussion behind that? Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu anhu, he has reported from that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he once prayed behind him. Anas ibn Malik, he once prayed behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He also prayed behind Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu. He also prayed behind Umar radiyallahu anhu. He also prayed behind Uthman radiyallahu anhu. And he said, now this is a hadith narrated in Bukhari and Muslim. He says, none of them didn't say this basmala. Okay, he narrates this. However, there is a second evidence that this evidence here has been narrated by Abu Hurairah radiyallahu anhu. He mentions that Abu Hurairah radiyallahu anhu, this is in Sahih Muslim, said that he will pray exactly as he saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is narrated in a number of different books. Nobody's prayer reflected more closely to the Prophet ﷺ's prayer than Abu Hurairah himself. And he says that I saw him, or I heard him say the basmala out loud. I heard him say the basmala out loud. So as a result, one should try to say the basmala. Now look at what the ulama did. You have one that says no, you have one that says yes. So what do you think the ulama did when they put it together? They said, occasionally you should do it, and occasionally you should refrain from it. Because you have two authentic evidences. One is narrated in Bukhari Muslim, the other one's narrated in Sahih Muslim. And these are not just your regular companions, these are major companions of the Prophet ﷺ. So you have Anas ibn Malik, then you have Abu Hurairah himself. So what do? Put them together, occasionally do this, occasionally do that. Should the followers of the Imam in the Jama'ah recite the Fatiha behind him? This depends on the prayer. Now we've discussed this briefly in our past sessions. We mentioned that some of the, you know, majority opinion, they encourage that you should recite the Fatiha for every single prayer after the Imam is done. But the problem is when you have those prayers like Fajr, Maghrib and Isha that's recited out loud, the issue is, what do you do under the circumstance here? Because it's very difficult for you to recite Fatiha whilst the Imam is reciting his surah. How do you fit that in? So this is why some of the ulama, and inshallah, you know, I find this to be one of the best fatwas issued, and this is from Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah. He mentions that in the loud prayers, Maghrib, Isha and Fajr, the follower should listen attentively to the recitation of the Imam and should not try to recite the Fatiha. He should only try to recite the Fatiha if the Imam is quiet. In other words, if the Imam gives you that opportunity to do that. And I've used this example before. When I used to pray in Medina, there was one Imam that was known to do this each and every time he would lead the salah, and that's of course Hudhayfi Hafizahullah, who is still the current imam for the masjid in Medina. Every single time you pray behind Hudhayfi, when he finishes his Fatiha, waladdallin, we say Ameen, there is always that pause. It's as if he intentionally does it just to cater for those who wish to do it. If that opportunity is there, Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah says that you should do it. Why? Because the general principle is فَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنَ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنصِتُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. Three things you want to accomplish, Allah mentions in Surah Al-A'raf. Whenever the Qur'an is recited, Allah Azza wa Jal says, the first thing I want you to do is to remain quiet and try to think and reflect and memorize. That's what istima' means. Istima' doesn't mean to just listen. It means to listen and listen carefully and try to think and ponder and allow the Qur'an to come to you. Allow the Qur'an to be the real music to your ears. So you're really listening to it and it's really affecting you. Then Allah says, وَأَنصِتُ. And we've talked about this way back in one of our previous halaqas, that it sounds almost repetitive. Allah says, istami'u, and then He says, ansitu, be quiet. If you're listening, aren't you already quiet? So why would Allah tell you to do it here and then tell you to be quiet after? And this is the difference. It's a slight difference, but it's a very effective one. When this istima', we mentioned that one of its connotations is you're not just listening, but you're trying to reflect and ponder. You're allowing the Qur'an to sink into your heart. If that becomes difficult for you, if there are too many distractions, then the least you should do is ansitu. That's the minimum you should do, is just at least remain quiet. Maybe the Qur'an is not getting to you the way you want it to at that moment, but at least you should do is to remain quiet. Why? لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. Maybe, hopefully, inshallah, Allah will have mercy upon you. You want this in your salah more than any other time in your life. Then Ibn Taymiyyah, he continues, if the imam's duration of quietness is not long enough, then the obligation of reciting the Fatiha is removed according to the strongest opinion. And he mentions this in his Majmu'. And it continues. He mentions that Imam Ahmad rahimahullah once said that the Muslims have all agreed that this verse was revealed regarding prayer. The same verse that I just recited to you in Surah Al-A'raf, it was actually revealed because of Salah itself. Then Ibn Taymiyyah continues, in the silent prayers, so these are Dhuhr and Asr, it is obligatory on the follower to recite the Fatiha. So you see what Ibn Taymiyyah is doing. And wallahi, Ibn Taymiyyah, when you read his works, and the same for his student Ibn Qayyim, this is the image you get from their material, is that they're always thinking outside the box. They're always categorizing knowledge. They're always categorizing issues in order that you understand them with ease and comfort. So he mentions here, the reason why in the Dhuhr and the Asr Salah you must recite the Fatiha, because obviously it's silence, so you can concentrate. You can't hear the Imam reciting, so there's no issue of listening to Quran here at that moment. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us, la salah, there is no prayer, liman lam yaqra bi fatihatil kitab, for the one who does not recite the Fatiha of the kitab. Let's just take one more and then we will pause for today, inshallah, simply because I have a meeting here that I want to get to, inshallah. One more mas'ala that we will look at, and that is the raf'ul yadain, or raising the hands before and after the ruku'. So you finish your Fatiha, you recite the surah, وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٍ, and then you say, Allahu Akbar, and you go for your ruku'. Well, a lot of people, they will raise the hands and go down for the ruku'. And when they say, Sami'a Allahu liman hamida, they raise the hands again. And then in other congregations or in other groups, you don't see that happening. So, what do we say about this particular, in terms of our discussion, about this particular mas'ala? For the sake of our discussion, I want to mention to you that Imam Shawkani rahimahullah mentions that there were more than 50 companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that have reported that he raised his hands to, before the ruku', and after the ruku' as well. And he continues, including all of the 10 that have been promised Jannah, the Ashr al-Mubashirin, right? All of the 10 have also reported this as well. And the hadith is at the level of mutawatir. So it is undisputable evidence. So this here, that's what I will leave you with. This, even though 50 companions, the Ashr al-Mubashirin, it's almost at mutawatir, even though we have this, it does lean you to one side that you should raise the hands. It still doesn't exclude the other side, where if somebody doesn't raise their hands, is this an innovation, or is their salah nullified, or did they make a mistake in the prayer where they have to do the sajda to sahum? Bil ijma' the ulama agree that's not the case. However, again, you always want to try to do the most common, the things that have evidences for them, you always want to lean with them as much as possible. You have majority of companions led to this one, so we encourage that. If you see somebody who prays and they don't raise their hand before and after the ruku', don't go and scrutinize them and interrogate them and say, Ya akhi, ittaqillah, you know what's your problem? You don't know how to pray? Don't do that, right? You know, unfortunately, this is some of the things that you know, as a da'i, you come in contact with occasionally. You know, some brothers, mashallah, really passionate, but they make mountains out of moles, if that makes any sense, right? So make issues, large issues, from small issues that really aren't priority issues when it comes to the sharia itself. However, at this point, inshallah, we will pause here, and we will continue with the manners of the prayer in our Friday session, inshallah. We will also look at how one may recite in terms of the prayer. How much Quran should you recite? Is there a difference of the amount of Quran that should be recited in Isha as opposed to Maghrib, as opposed to Fajr? How long should they be? There's a narration that one of the companions, he wanted to pray Salatul Dhuhr in the Haram with the Prophet and he didn't have wudu. So the Prophet ﷺ was about to start the prayer, and he started it. He said, Allahu Akbar, and he started Dhuhr. Now this companion wanted to go and perform wudu, but he didn't have access to water unless he walked where the Baqir or the cemetery is, which is right beside the Haram. Those of you who've gone to Medina, it is kind of a distance between that graveyard or that cemetery and to where the Prophet ﷺ stood. It's a good distance. Point is that this companion, he walks out, and he goes all the way to the Baqir, he performs wudu, and then he comes back, and he still caught the first raka'ah of Salatul Dhuhr of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So how long should it be? What happens if you just recite in Isha Surat al-Ikhlas or Surat al-Kawthar in the first raka'ah, and then you recite Surat al-Ikhlas in the second raka'ah, and you do this for Salatul Isha? Is this something acceptable? It is acceptable, but I mean, should you do this? Is this something that's, you know, encouraged in the sharia? Or is there some karaha behind it? So what are some of the rulings, and how much should you recite? So this is something very practical, especially for the imams, of how much and what kind of surahs that you choose to recite and lead the jama'ah. You should be very selective in what surahs you recite. What happens if a person starts a surah in the first raka'ah but doesn't complete it, but in the second raka'ah they don't continue that surah, they jump into another surah and leave that one halfway? What's the ruling behind that? Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah actually wrote a small risala or a book regarding this issue. What happens if you recite a portion of Baqarah in the first raka'ah, but in the second raka'ah you recite from Baqarah, but you recite one of the earlier verses? See what happened? Or let's just say the first raka'ah you recite Surat An-Nas, second raka'ah you recite Surat Al-Baqarah. You didn't follow the order of the Quran. Is that something to be scrutinized about? Is that an issue as well? What happens if you do this? I mean, this is no joke. A brother told me that he prayed behind an imam in another city, thank God, that, you know, he prayed behind this imam, and the imam did this. غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. Everybody said آمين. الرجال قوامون على النساء. الله أكبر.
You see what happened? He cut a verse in half. He said that men are more superior than women, and he stopped there. And he went for ruku'. And then the second rak'ah, he chose another verse and he continued. So what's the ruling behind this? Or if somebody, now this here, we're not going to cut a verse in half, but can somebody pray and do,
قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدُ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ اللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ.
And then the second rak'ah, continue from there. So the point I'm trying to make here is that, can you cut Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sentences halfway and then pray? This is what we're looking at. Obviously that ar-rijalu qawwamun 'ala an-nisaa' is just silly, right? Because you're sending the wrong image, you're sending the wrong tafsir, you're sending the wrong ayah, and obviously this is something that is very disrespectful when you recite Quran. Is that not only are you cutting in the middle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sentence, but it's not an appropriate way to do it either. So these are just some of the little things, inshallah, that I will explain and we will discuss in our next halaqa as well. I will also give just some tips. These are just some of the things that I learned praying behind all of the imams over the years. Just some small tips of selecting certain surahs and which surahs should be attached to that. So for example, you have the last part of Surah At-Tawbah. My Huffaz al-Qur'an, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِتُمْ حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. This verse all the way to the end is talking about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was the person, who was a human being, حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ. He had so much love and desire to spread the message of Islam to the people. That's the first rak'ah. Now you have to be very smart to do this. And you have to know some Arabic and you have to know a little bit of tafsir. But the second rak'ah, just to make the salah just be, you know, feel a little more tasty and a little more delicious to the people behind you, the second rak'ah, you're going to choose a verse now that complements that one. So what is one of the verses that complements that story or that point, that statement that you just made? The second rak'ah, you'll choose the end of Surah Yunus. قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ. Huh? How does it go? Where's my Hufad? Nobody here doesn't... Where's my Hafidh al-Qur'an? I think I just saw one of them. قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ. Huh? It's not رَسُولٌ. No. I'm going to leave you that to that one as well. But the point is that verse, it complements that first rak'ah. Because what it says is that Allah Azza wa Jal now sent you a Rasul, and what the message that he came with is the haqq. Do you see what happened? So the first one is the Prophet ﷺ had the haris, he had the desire to spread the message. The second rak'ah complements it because قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, verily I have sent down the Rasul with the haqq. مَنِ اهْتَدَى فَإِنَّمَا يَهْتَدِي لِنَفْسِهِ. Whoever follows him, for verily they've followed him and they've gotten guidance for themselves. That's how they complement each other. You got to be smart to do that. And you have to obviously know a lot of the Quran, inshallah, to do that. These are some of the things that we will discuss in our next halaqah session, which will happen on Friday after Salatul Maghrib, bi'aunillahi ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shower His rahmah and His acceptance and His security upon each and every single one of us. And write down for us a qabool and acceptance for our salawat and our du'at and all of our acts of worship that we perform and we struggle and we do in this world. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it from us. These are the words that we leave you with. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. please, if you just excuse me, if you have any questions, inshallah, you can come to the office. I really have to get to a meeting. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.